Good evening. A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. Vanity of vanities, says Qoheleth, vanity of vanities, all things are vanity. What is humanity's benefit for all its labor under the sun? One generation passes and another comes, but the world forever stays. The sun rises and the sun goes down. Then it presses on to the place where it rises, blowing now toward the south, then toward the north. The wind turns again and again, resuming its rounds. All rivers go to the sea, yet never does the sea become full. To the place where they go, the rivers keep on going. All speech is labored. There is nothing one can say. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor is the ear satisfied with hearing. What has been, that will be. What has been done, that will be done. Nothing is new under the sun. Even the thing of which we say, see, this is new, has already existed in the ages that preceded us. There is no remembrance of things past, nor will there be any remembrance of things to come by those who come even later. The word of God.
Today's psalm response is, God has been our refuge in every age. God has been our refuge in every age. You turn humankind back to dust, saying, return, creatures of the earth. For 1,000 years in your sight are as yesterday, now that it is past, or as a watch of the night. God has been our refuge in every age. You make an end of them in their sleep. The next morning they are like the changing grass, which at dawn springs up anew, but by the evening wilts and fades. God has been our refuge in every age. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain wisdom of heart. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. God has been our refuge in every age. Fill us at daybreak with your kindness, that we may shout for joy and gladness all our days. Prosper the work of our hands for us. Prosper the work of our hands. God has been our refuge in every age.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Herod the Tetrarch heard about all that Jesus was doing, and he was greatly perplexed because some were saying, John has been raised from the dead. Others were saying, Elijah has appeared. Still others, one of the ancient prophets has arisen. But Herod said, John I beheaded. Who then is this about whom I hear such things? And he kept trying to see Jesus. The Gospel of the Lord. So back in 1998, Spiritus Christi wasn't quite born yet. And Father Jim and Reverend Myra and so many of the leaders that are still with us here today, we're working at a Corpus Christi church, a Roman Catholic church over on the corner of Prince and Main Street. And they were doing amazing work in the community, creating health centers and support systems for people coming out of prison. And the entire Corpus Christi community was flourishing. During this time, there were three things they were practicing that would be considered non-traditional, to put it lightly, from the viewpoint of the Roman Catholic Church. These practices were having women on the altar, marrying gay couples, and giving communion to everyone. And back in the 90s, you can imagine this ruffled a few feathers. It definitely still does today. And so when the Vatican got wind of it, they sent over a letter. And in the letter, they proposed an ultimatum. Either you stop these three practices and sign a document repenting for your sins, or you will be excommunicated from the Roman Catholic Church. Not really great choices either way, but we knew the choice that we had to make. And that was to stand strong in our truths and followed what we believed are Jesus' ideals. So we didn't sign the paper. And we continued the practices, and we were excommunicated. It was time for something new. And as Reverend Myra said in her homily the other week, Finding a Way Forward, Jesus taught us that you can't put new wine in an old wineskin. And I'll tell you what, that wine that we were brewing up here in Rochester had a whole new flavor. So we needed a new wineskin to hold it. And that process of creation started with just getting together as a community, gathering in the streets, demonstrating, doing caravans, promoting, and making some noise for what we believed in about the inclusion we felt that the church was missing. We didn't know what it would look like right away, but we kept gathering and using our collective brilliance and believing in that brilliance to design a church that truly embodied Jesus' message of unconditional love. During that time, there was a phrase that really captured the movement. And that phrase was, "You can cut back the flowers, but you can't hold back the spring." Oftentimes in movements for social justice, there is a system in place that is designed to cut back the flowers. In the gospel today, we see Herod trying to cut back the flowers. Herod has a system that's designed to give him the power to silence, but it doesn't give him a guarantee. Beheading John was his attempt to use his power to silence, but it didn't work because then came Jesus. And Jesus wanted to flip that whole system upside down. He wanted to serve the poor and vulnerable. He wanted to use nonviolent resolution strategies. And he was preaching that putting your faith in material things, that was fake news. So this was Jesus' dream. And as hard as Herod would try, he would never be able to kill that dream. We know that. And in the words of MLK, "You can kill a man, but you can't kill a dream." Today we have a dream in the United States that needs to be fulfilled. It's pretty hard to talk about at this point because of how long it's taking and how long the United States has been cutting back the flowers of racial equality. I had the privilege of going to the African American History Museum in Washington, D.C., and it tells this story in a very powerful way. To start the museum, I took an elevator down to the basement where I was transported back 400 years to the hull of a ship where slaves were being transported from Africa to the Americas. As I read about the story of the start of slavery, a heavy feeling sat on me. I could feel it sitting on my shoulders. I could feel it sinking into my chest. And as I walked through the museum and really stepped through history, one year and one story at a time, I continued to carry that feeling. I got to the top of the museum on the top floor, saw Barack Obama, Oprah Winfrey, Muhammad Ali, LeBron James, all these awesome stories, but alongside all of these stories, I still continue to see stories of racism and long lists of black men and women who were killed by police brutality. What really stuck with me as I stood there and looked at the current state of racism in our country was that I still had that feeling that I did on the bottom floor of the museum when I looked at the founding of slavery 400 years ago. That feeling didn't go away. It still stuck with me when I looked at racism today. So in an interview near the end of his life, Dr. King said that his deepest sadness was that America had committed to a series of installment plans for justice for black people. Many of us have had an installment plan. Maybe it was a car, 3 or 5 years. Maybe it was a house mortgage, 15, 30, 40 years. Well, in our country, we signed the Constitution since 1787 with a promise of equality and freedom for our for all people. And this year marks the 233rd year of America's installment plan for racial justice. So it's too long. We have to do something. We have to see something new and make a change. At the end of the gospel today, Herod also wants to see Jesus. He wants to see the truth. And he says, "Let me see Jesus. I want to see Jesus." And I think that's a good question to ask. What truths do we need to ask to see right now? Where do we need to ask God to reveal Jesus to us? When Daniel Prude was killed here in Rochester, I was blessed to be here at Spiritus Christi, where I could be on the ground level with leaders like Reverend Myra Brown and Kristen Walker. And on the third night of protesting, Kristen asked me if I could support the movement by helping to keep some rooms open here at the Spiritus as sanctuary space for people that may be hurt during the protest. When she asked that to me, I could feel some fear creeping up inside me, but my faith took over, and it told me not to give consideration to fear. I knew that I was being called to make a faith decision, and that night, God would lead me through whatever would happen. So I called up Aaron Lynch, our video production guy. He grabbed his buddy Joey, his roommate. My fiance Amanda came. I couldn't stop her if I wanted to. And Dr. Lorinda Parks joined us as well, who's a parishioner and a doctor here at Spiritus. So there we were, Saturday night, I think it was September 6th, and we had our team down here at 6:30 p.m. to set up shop. Around 9:30, the protesters made their way down to City Hall, and they began chanting, "Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter. Say his name, Daniel Prude. Say his name, Daniel Prude." From City Hall, the protesters continued on, rounding the corner and heading towards Main Street and Exchange. And there, they were met by metal barricades and lines of police officers in riot gear. Over at Spiritus, while this was happening, it was almost too quiet. We were out on the ramp on the side of the building thinking, hey, maybe we should go home soon. Nothing's happening. And then all of a sudden, everything happened at once. The sound of loud bangs, screaming, and blaring horns filled the air. Someone came running down the street towards us, yelling, "They're trying to clear out the protesters." In this moment, Lorinda's instincts as a doctor took over, and she began running towards the action, looking for people that needed help. Amanda and I ran up with her, and as we rounded the corner, the scene we laid our eyes upon was truly shocking. It was surreal, like something you'd think you'd see in a movie, not here on Main Street in Rochester. People were running behind by us in all directions, covering their faces from the chemicals in the air. And Lorinda made a beeline for a woman she saw slouched against the wall of a building. The woman had been hit with a pepper ball and was struggling to breathe and having a panic attack. We all tried to stay calm as we got her into a van to take her back to Spiritus. Another woman was in the van who was yelling in pain from what we would later find out was probably a broken ankle, and from a pepper ball that exploded in her eyes and on her body. As she was fighting against the pain of the chemicals in her eyes, I was looking at her, and lying next to her was a shield. And it was just one of those saucers that you go sledding down. And she just spray-painted BLM on it. Kind of made me think of Jesus on the donkey, just whatever supplies are laying around. And although she could barely open her eyes, when she squinted up at us, I could see Jesus. Spirit has quickly turned into the main triage post for injured protesters. All of a sudden, teams of volunteer medics were setting up alongside Dr. Parks, and protesters were coming into the sanctuary for refuge and to recollect themselves. As folks took reprieve inside of Spiritus, we received word that the police were pushing back protesters from City Hall down towards the church. As the protesters began to get pushed back, they looked and saw that on the other side of the street, it was also blocked off by police and that they were bottled in. Protesters were backed up and rounded into the alcove in front of Spiritus Christi. They had nowhere to go, but the officers continued to tell them to disperse. We quickly realized we needed to get everybody inside as soon as possible. Protest organizers began yelling, "Everyone, get inside right now." And as the protesters flooded up the ramp to get inside the Spiritus sanctuary, the police officers began firing pepper balls down on the area where the protesters were still gathered. From the entrance where I stood, I could see the pepper balls exploding against the side of the church building. The 40 or 50 officers in their riot gear then wrapped around the church all the way up against the entrances, blocking any way out. As the last protesters came up the ramp and got inside, we looked down the ramp entrance where there was a sliding metal gate. The officer standing at that gate grabbed it, and with all the force he could muster, violently slammed it closed. The violence of that action reverberated straight into my heart, and I can still feel the pain from that moment in my body today. As I stared out at the officer through the metal bars, trapped inside the church, I got a sense of what it feels like to be oppressed. While this exchange happened by the doors, an entirely different exchange was happening here inside of the sanctuary. Serendipitously, one of my friends from childhood showed up that night, and she spent the night inside Spiritus' sanctuary with the intention of providing emotional support for people that needed a listener. What she found was that folks didn't need her mental health services in the ways that she had anticipated. Instead of wanting to talk, folks were just sitting in silence. It wasn't a bad silence. They were just sitting with their sadness, their hope, and their grief. She said to me, and I quote her here, "I believe that the quality of this space, a literal church sanctuary, had a big effect on the quality of the gathering. When people gather for worship in the same space, for years on end, that place takes on a deep spiritual presence. The Virgin Mary was there that night holding the protesters. Jesus was there that night holding the protesters. The protesters were there that night holding each other." And that sanctuary is the sanctuary that we're sitting in tonight. I like to end with a reference to a song from one of my favorite singers, Bob Marley, and his song, Redemption Song. In it, he sings, "How long will they kill our prophets while we stand along and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book." Well, 400 years of cutting back the flowers has made a very long book. Perhaps this is our moment to write the ending.
From the bottomless pit, but my head. emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can be free. Our minds have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part.